Okay, so just a quick review of what we have done last time. We derived the formula for least square estimation purely through geometric arguments. So we said that the error between the predicted and the known or measured values predicted by the model and the known values of the dependent variable, that error should be perpendicular to the subspace spanned by columns of matrix A. So we had this model which was U is equal to A theta plus E, where E is the error vector. So we just made geometric arguments, something that you know from your school, is this error vector u minus a theta, this should be perpendicular, this should be orthogonal to the column space of, so e should be, in the least square estimation, e is perpendicular to the column space . What is column space of A? Span of columns of A. Column space is nothing but span of columns of A. So this error should be orthogonal to this. Just using this simple argument, that is argument of projection, we arrived at the basic formula, that was theta least square is equal to A transpose A inverse A transpose U. So we could arrive at this fundamental result, which earlier we had arrived through algebra, through geometry. Okay. So today what I want to do is extend this beyond just finite dimensional spaces, also give you some more insights, geometric insights in the finite dimensional spaces. Next class, after this, we will start applying it for different purposes. So again, let's again stick to the interpretation part of it. As I said, there's a third way of interpreting all these things, that is through statistics. Unfortunately, we don't have time to get into that. But I'm going to just upload my notes about statistical interpretation. So those of you who are interested should go and look at the notes. But that is extra reading, and this is a postgraduate course, so you should do extra reading. It's not that just you end, the things end here. What we actually managed to cover in this course is the tip of the iceberg. So we derived this formula, okay, and I want to generalize this to some extent to any Hilbert space, approximation in any Hilbert space. Before that, let's look at some geometric insights. Now, I just now defined column space of A. Probably in some other course you also have looked about other spaces that are associated with a matrix. What are the other spaces that are associated with a matrix? Null space. What about row space? What is a row space? Span of rows. Span of rows. Okay. Or span of columns of A transpose. Okay. So column space of A transpose is nothing but the row space. So we just need to know a little bit about these four spaces. So given a matrix A, okay, span of span of columns of A is called as column space of A, then span of row space of A. Row space of A is nothing but span of A transpose, or set of all possible linear combinations of rows. Okay, what is null space? What is null space of A? Ax equal to 0. So, null space of A, this corresponds to set of all x such that Ax equal to 0 vector. So, set of all x such that Ax equal to 0 vector, this is called as null space of A. And there is one more space associated with matrix that is called as left null space. Okay. So, left null space is nothing but null space of A transpose. Null space of A transpose is called as left null space of A. Okay. So, there are four fundamental subspaces associated with a matrix. Okay. One of them is the column space. Column space is all possible linear combinations of columns of A. Row space, span of row vectors. Null space, set of all x such that Ax equal to 0. And left null space, that is set of all vectors y such that A transpose y is equal to 0. Okay. So, these are four fundamental subspaces, and what you are going to see, or what you will realize here when I go to this. Okay. We split a vector u. This vector u was split into two components. One component was the projection, P. So, we are able to split a vector by this approach. Geometrically, what we are doing? We are splitting the vector into two components. What are the two components? One is in the column space. This is in the column space because A theta is nothing but linear combination of columns of A. Right? A theta is linear combination of columns of A. So, this vector has to belong to column space of A. Okay. So, if I just draw this picture again here, if you have a two-dimensional, if you have a matrix with a 3x2 matrix with two linearly independent columns, let's say this is the first column A1 and this is A2 and this is my U vector. This diagram I had drawn earlier, this is my U vector. So, this is the projection. This is the P vector. This is the projection vector which is lying in the column space of A. Okay. Then there is an orthogonal component. What do you mean by orthogonal component? Orthogonal component lies in the null space of this matrix. The orthogonal component lies in the null space. Does it lie in the null space or does it lie in the left null space? Just think about it. Where does it lie? Where does the orthogonal component lie? Does it lie in the null space or left null space? So, we are able to split a vector into two components in the column space and orthogonal to the column space. Okay. Will a vector belonging to null space be orthogonal to the column space? What is the property of a vector that is orthogonal to the any vector that is orthogonal to column space? Yeah, A times that vector, okay, A times that vector will give me 0 vector, okay. Of course, E is not in the null space, E is in the left null space. Just think about it. E is in the left null space, and P is in the column space. P is in the column space. Okay, so there's a fundamental theorem of linear algebra. Okay, I'm just going to mention it here without getting into the proof. You can refer to Strang's book or you can refer to any linear algebra book for this. Now, the column space of A is often referred as R of A. The column space is often referred as R of A, and the null space is often referred as N of A. N stands for null space, A is null space of A. So there is one fundamental theorem of linear algebra which says that, I think you know this. You know this result. I am just going to state it again. Number of linearly independent columns, okay, is equal to number of linearly independent rows. In any matrix, number of linearly independent columns is always equal to number of linearly independent rows, which is equal to rank, okay, which is equal to rank. So this is the algebraic result which you know, which is also a geometric result, because linearly independent columns, okay, it relates rank, which is a algebraic quantity, with a geometric property, that linear independence. Okay, so what is the dimension of the column space? Dimension of column space is always equal to rank. Okay, so the fundamental theorem of linear algebra dimension of row space of A, dimension of column space of A is equal to rank of A. Okay, I am looking at a matrix A which is n cross m. I have a n cross m matrix, so dimension of column space of A is equal to rank of A, dimension of null space is equal to n minus rank of A. Then dimension of row space of A transpose, sorry, column space of A transpose, that is nothing but row space, is equal to rank of A. And dimension of null space of A transpose, m minus rank A. Number of columns is m. Yeah. If I put n cross m, then it should be m minus rank A, and then this should be n minus. Agreed. This should be n minus rank A. Okay, this is just the background. This is a well-known result. I am just stating it again. Okay, now with this background, I am going to prove some nice algebraic properties of projection that we have looked at. Okay, so now actually what we have achieved is a way of splitting a vector into two components. See, we found out a least square estimate, right? And how did we get the least square estimate? So theta least square, this was A transpose A inverse A transpose U. Correct? This is how we got the least square estimate. Okay. So, what is the projection? See, we are talking of two things, right? One is this projection onto the column space. Other is a vector error which is perpendicular to the column space. Okay. So how do I project, given a matrix A, how do I project it onto its column space? Okay. So the projection P is given by A times theta hat LS, right? The projection, we found out the theta which projects. Now projection vector itself, what is the projection vector? A times theta. Okay. So this is nothing but A transpose A inverse A transpose U, correct? A transpose A inverse A transpose U. Okay. If I call this matrix as projection PR matrix, let me call this matrix as PR. Okay. Where does this vector P lie? The vector P lies in the column space of A. So given a matrix A, how do I project any vector onto its column space? I take matrix A, I find out this matrix, this is called projection matrix. This projection matrix projects any vector U onto the column space of A. Okay. See, because look at this theta here. See, theta happens to be this, but what is theta? Theta is a least square estimate, is some number. So A times theta is nothing but linear combination of columns of A. So P has to lie in the column space of A. Okay. So actually what we have done is we have found out a way, given a matrix A which is non-square, which is actually tall matrix, it has more rows than the columns. For such a tall matrix, we know how to project any vector U onto the column space. Okay, this is the component along the column space. What is the component which is orthogonal to the column space? So that is E. So how do you get E? E is U minus A theta least square. Okay, that is U minus A transpose A inverse A transpose U, which is I minus projection matrix. What is this? I minus projection matrix. Everyone with me on this? I minus projection matrix. Okay. You can check that P is orthogonal to E. Take inner product of P and E. Okay. You will get zero. These two are orthogonal components. So now given a vector U, we know how to split this vector into two components, one in the column space, other orthogonal to the column space. Okay. This matrix A into A transpose A inverse A transpose is called as a projection matrix. There is something very nice about the projection matrix. Is projection matrix symmetric? Is it symmetric matrix? If you take transpose of this matrix, what will you get? I am not going to do it on the board. Just think about it. There is one very nice property of this projection matrix. I want you to check it. And I want you to understand what is its meaning. This is a very funny matrix. It is square of itself. Yes. This matrix has a very nice property. PR square is equal to PR. Can you check this? Just multiply PR into PR. You will get back PR. Mind you, this is not an identity matrix. This is not an identity matrix. And you have to explain me geometrically what is meaning of PR into PR is equal to PR. First of all, are you able to get this? Is this coming out? Just multiply. What is A into A transpose A inverse A transpose A? A transpose A inverse A transpose. Right? This A transpose A inverse A transpose A, this will become identity. You will get A transpose A inverse A transpose. This is not a matrix, this is not an identity matrix. Yet it has this very nice property. It is square of itself. What is the geometric meaning of this? Yeah. Yes. Not matrix, vector U. Huh. Plane. Same vector, precisely. Very, very nice. So if you project the projection again, you will get the same vector, right? See, here, this my U vector is split into two components, projection and orthogonal to the projection. Now this projection, if I project again onto the plane, what should I get? The same vector, because there is no, the best approximation of this vector inside this plane is this vector itself. Okay? This vector itself. So the geometric interpretation of projection square, okay, you can just go on, you can just say projection cube is also equal to very, 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 very nice matrix. Okay? Vice versa. Any matrix that has this property is called as projection matrix. That is square of itself is a projection matrix. Okay? So this is a nice property of projection matrix. You can go on multiplying it with itself and you will get back the same matrix. What about transpose? Is the transpose of this matrix symmetric matrix? Okay? PR transpose. It's a symmetric matrix. Okay? It's a symmetric matrix. It's square of itself. Okay. What will be projection matrix? If your U is perpendicular, just without computing, you should tell me what should be the projection matrix if U is perpendicular? Projection matrix should be 0. Because the best approximation of U which is perpendicular to this plane is the zero vector. Okay, so projections, least square approximations associate these geometric ideas. Okay, then you will remember it better than just what happens if U is already inside. We talked about it. If U is already inside, you will get back the same vector, so same matrix. So it is projection matrix is, and what happens when it is square? If A matrix is square matrix, then what is the projection matrix? If A is a square invertible matrix, if A is square invertible, what will be the projection matrix? A is square and invertible. So what is A transpose A inverse? It is A into A inverse, which is I, into A transpose inverse into A transpose, which is I. Identity matrix. Okay? So, if A is full rank and square, okay, projection matrix will turn out to be identity matrix. There will be no error. You are already in the full space. Yeah. Okay, so now I am going to generalize this to any Hilbert space. This is a very nice result, and then we need to extract its full potential. We should not just restrict ourselves to n dimensions. Till now I have been looking only at n dimensions. Why not go ahead and look at, you know, any Hilbert space, any infinite dimensional space? In fact, what you will see is that soon what will pop out is Fourier series, not just the Fourier series, but generalized Fourier series. Okay. Let's look at this very quickly, because this is something which probably Fourier series haunts you from your second year of engineering, and then this will probably explain you the basis as to how it works, why Fourier series, why we look at orthogonal functions and so on. Okay, so now what I want to do is to generalize this result into any Hilbert space. So what we are going to look at now is see, basically when you will study all these methods, numerical methods for solving partial differential equations, boundary value problems, algebraic equations, whatever, I want you to remember all these geometric insights, all this, you know, it's not just the procedure, it's these foundations which help you to modify, to tweak, to twist for a particular, you know, application. Because if you want to really concoct a solution for a given problem, you cannot many times just rely on the standard tools. You have to come up with some way of, you know, concocting a new solution procedure. That's where you should understand all these fundamentals. Okay, should know where it is arising from, how whole thing was derived, and then you can just derive another approach if you need to. So that is critical. Okay, so just like let's take a look at what we have done till now. What we have said that I have a way of projecting a vector. Okay, so we looked at a three dimensions. We looked at a vector which is outside the plane, you know, and then suppose this is the plane. No, I have a way of projecting this vector onto this plane and a vector component, a component which is perpendicular to this plane. Okay, in general, I said, well, why just a two dimensional plane? If I have a vector in Rn and I have a subspace in Rn, okay, I have an m dimensional subspace, I know how to find a component lying in the subspace and orthogonal to the subspace, right? We looked at m dimensions, and n dimensional vectors being projected onto m dimensional subspace and a component which is orthogonal, So we were able to split in finite dimensional vector spaces. We were able to extend our school geometry that, you know, the shortest distance of a point from a subspace or from a plane is draw a perpendicular. I want to do the same thing in any Hilbert space. Why can I do this? In Hilbert space, I have inner product with me. Since I have inner product with me, I have orthogonality. I can talk about projections. I can just talk about, you know, two vectors being orthogonal to each other. Okay. So I can just talk about now, you know, taking a subspace in a Hilbert space. Okay. Or taking a subspace in an inner product space, any space on which inner product is defined. And then in that subspace, okay, and given a vector which is outside this space, I can project this vector onto the subspace, right? I can find a component of the vector along the, you know, in the subspace and component perpendicular to the subspace. Okay. So what was the trick? The trick was that the component which is error, okay, or approximation error, is orthogonal to the subspace. Okay. So I find the error vector, find its orthogonal, and, you know, that will help me to come up with approximations. See, for example, just to motivate, you know, let's say I have this function ft a plus bt, where a and b are some known values. Okay, and then I want to approximate this function using, I want to construct an approximation, let's say g of t, which is alpha sin t plus beta cos t. Is this a vector? It's a vector. Let's say this is a vector in where t belongs to 0 to 2 pi. Is this a vector? This function is a vector. This is a continuous function over 0 to 2 pi. I want to construct an approximation alpha sin t plus beta cos t for this vector. So what do I mean by that? The error, what is the error function? What is the error vector? Error vector, let me call this et, will be ft minus gt. Ft minus gt. Okay, what is the subspace here? What is the subspace that these two vectors span? It's a two-dimensional subspace, right? Two-dimensional subspace of set of continuous functions between 0 to 2 pi. Why two-dimensional? There are two linearly independent vectors, sin t, cos t. Okay, there are two linearly independent vectors, sin t, cos t. Now, thus we extend our ideas of projection. What should happen? This error function should be orthogonal to subspace. Which subspace? Sin t and cos t. Two dimensional subspace, sin, which is spanned by all possible linear combinations of sin t and cos t. So this should be perpendicular to span of sin t cos t. This error, this approximation error between the function, original function, and the approximation. Okay, see, this a and b are known constants. Let's take as 1 plus 5t. Let's take specific. A and b are not known. We have to find out a and b, least square approximation. Okay, I want to get a least square approximation. So I want to get a least square approximation of this. I am just taking very simple function. In general, you may have a very complex function which you need to approximate. For example, you may have data which is actually coming from, daily temperature variation, which is cyclic, right? Daily temperature variation is cyclic. And you could approximate using sine and cos functions. You could develop very nice approximations. So, I want to develop the approximation alpha and beta, what is the advantage of, let's say I have data for temperature variation throughout the day. Okay? Throughout the day. What is the advantage of fitting? See, what I mean is, I collect temperature at every 5 minutes and I plot it. See, let's say it is, every 5 minutes I have plotted. You have data for 5 minutes for 24 hours. How many data points? 12 per hour into 24. So many data points. If I have to save this data for years, let's imagine how much data I have to save. Okay. As against, if I am able to fit sine and cos. Okay. So, I fit some sine and cos, which is approximation, which doesn't pass through every point. Okay. Nevertheless, sort of gives me a best fit, least square fit. Okay, for today, suppose I have to save data for today. For today's data, okay, I could find alpha and beta for today's data. I have to save only two numbers. You must have heard about data compression, right? You heard about data compression. This is a data compression algorithm. Data for 5 minutes for temperature for the entire day can be compressed and written in terms of only 4 numbers or 2 numbers. If you are not happy with sin t cos t, add 2 more, sin 2t cos 2t. Okay, and then you will be able to get an approximation of temperature versus time. And instead of saving all this 12 into 24 values for one day, I could just save two approximation coefficients. All that I have to know that these two approximation coefficients correspond to sine and cos. I multiply them, I can get a very good approximation of what happened on that day, right? It may not be accurate to the extent that it may not be passing through every point. Doesn't matter. But I can get a trend. Okay? I can get a trend. So this is very, very important. Very, very important. Okay. So let's leave this aside for a while. Let's look at this problem. We want to get geometric insights and we want to extend them to. Okay. So now what should happen is this error should be perpendicular to span of these two vectors. Now in general, my model could be of this form. Okay, let me write a general model. My general model is ut is equal to, this is my general model. Okay, I'll just make one small change here just to be consistent with our notation. Let's call this P, because this is the projection. This is the projection. Let's call it P. Okay. And then here, let me call this as UT. Okay. Now let's come back here. So in general, my UT, okay, is some linear combination of these known vectors, A1T, A2T, A3T, AMT are known vectors, just like sin t, cos t. Okay, you want to project this onto some known subspace. Okay, you know its basis vectors. Okay, and linear combination of these basis vectors will define that subspace. What is all possible linear combination of this A1 to AM? If they are linearly independent, it will be M dimensional subspace. Right, it will be M dimensional subspace. Now, the question is, if I give you UT, okay, can you find out alpha 1, alpha 2, which are least square? How do you find out alpha 1, alpha 2, which is least square? So this part here is the projection. This part here is the projection onto the subspace defined by span of A1 to AM, right? So I want to find out project UT on okay. Now, just for the sake of convenience of notation, I am going to drop this T, 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 T. I am just going to work with U, P, A1, A2. So T is there. I am just going to drop it for the sake of convenience. Otherwise, the writing will become cluttered. What I am saying here and what I told you here is not different. Just remember this. This is just a two-dimensional example. Okay. Here, so this is my A1. This is my A1T and this is my A2T. This is my A1T, this is my A2T, right? The subspace which is spanned by linear combination of these two vectors is two-dimensional. In general, you may have m such vectors and you are talking about distance of a point from the subspace. Same problem, okay? Visualization will not be different from what you know in three dimensions, but I am just extending it to any m dimensional subspace of an infinite dimensional space. Okay. So the projection theorem, I am not, the statement is, formal statement is given here. The projection theorem says that U minus P, that is equal to error, is orthogonal. The statement of the projection theorem, classical projection theorem on Hilbert spaces, is that error is orthogonal to the error, the point which is at the least distance from the point in the subspace, which is at least distance from a point outside, can be reached, okay, by dropping a perpendicular, which you know from three dimensions. Same result holds here, that error is perpendicular to the subspace. Okay, that is the statement of this theorem. Formal statement is given here. I am just compressing and writing here that this error vector is orthogonal to the span. So this is my, let's call this subspace S. Okay, is orthogonal to the span. Now how am I going to use this to compute alpha 1 to alpha m? Okay, so now what I am going to do is very, very simple. Okay, I am going to start. I know that this is orthogonal to a1 to am. Okay, which means this error is orthogonal to a1, is also orthogonal to a2, is also orthogonal to a3. So one by one, I am going to write these equations. Okay, so I am going to say my first equation is that in a product, see now I am just generalizing this result. I am saying in a product of u minus p into ai is equal to 0, right? U minus p, is this okay? What is the meaning of this statement? U minus p, this error vector, is orthogonal for I is equal to 1, 2, up to m. How many equations I need? How many unknowns are there? There are m unknowns, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, up to alpha m. There are m unknowns. Okay, I need to write m equations. Okay, here are my m equations. I am just going to use them. Okay, so just look at this. Well, I will just rearrange this and write it. I will say that this means that in the product of uai is equal to these two are same equations, right? I am just rewriting them. I am just expanding and writing this equation. So I am going to use this now to create. So what is this? Okay, so this equation, first equation, is that, you know, alpha 1 a1 plus up to alpha m am inner product a1 is equal to u inner product a1, right? So this equation will actually be, can be written as alpha 1 a1 inner product a1 plus alpha 2 a2 inner product a1 alpha m am inner product a1 is equal to u inner product a1, right? I am just expanding this equation. What is my second equation? So second equation, if I just write like this and expand, what will I get? I will get alpha 1 a2 in a product a1 in a product a2 plus alpha 2 a2 in a product a2 alpha m am in a product a2 is equal to u in a product a2. Okay, how many such equations I have? I have m equations. Okay, so alpha 1 a1 in a product am up to finally up to alpha m am in a product am is equal to u am. Is everyone with me on this? How many equations you have got? M equations in m unknowns. Okay, do I know these vectors a1, a2, a3, am? I know these vectors. I have chosen them. Sine, cos. Okay, sine 2, cos 2, and so on. So I know these vectors. So if I know these vectors, okay, this inner products can be computed. Okay, whatever integral over 0 to 2 pi, you can compute them. Okay, you can compute them. And then this equation can be solved this equation can be solved because you have m equations in m unknowns. Is it a linear equation? It's a linear equation. It's like matrix times vector is equal to some vector. U is known to you. A1 to am are known to you. So right hand side is known to you. All these coefficients or inner products are known to you. Alpha 1 to alpha m is not known. Okay. Now just see what is the advantage of choosing these vectors to be orthogonal. Suppose A1, A2, A3, am are orthogonal. What will be this inner product? Zero. Okay, which inner product will not be 0? A11, A22, A33, A44. Yes. If you choose orthogonal vectors, okay, the solution is particularly very easy. Then you will get first equation will be alpha 1 times this is equal to. Actually, what we have derived is nothing but generalized Fourier expansion. I will just come to this in my next lecture very briefly. This is, if you take A1 to AM to be orthogonal, what you get are nothing but Fourier coefficients. This is called as generalized Fourier expansion, and then we'll get Fourier coefficient. Fourier expansion need not be only with sine cos. Tomorrow, in some function, you know, you want to approximate some function over some domain, say 0 to 1, using shifted Legendre polynomials. Why shifted Legendre polynomials? Shifted Legendre polynomials are orthogonal polynomials. Okay, and then this approximation will be very easy. So we'll continue on this. This particular equation is called as normal equation, and this is like a cornerstone of optimization projections and helps us in discretizing and so on. Okay, so actually if you go back and look a little bit carefully, this is not different from A transpose A inverse or A transpose A into theta is equal to A transpose U, because inner product of columns A transpose A, if you take columns of A, inner product of the same equation written in a generic form for any Hilbert space, same equation, not different. Okay. So let's stop here and then let's continue with its interpretations in our next lecture.